Hello and welcome to Streamers and Punches, the podcast from SoundNotionTV that looks at current events and new releases in the world of film music. I'm Kevin Wilt.
And I'm Bill Witham.
Today we kind of have a whole mixed bag of things we're going to deal with. Bill, why don't you start us off with our headlines today?
Well, we got kind of a whole potpourri of things we wanted to cover. Actually, if you'll recall, a week ago, or I think it might have been 2 weeks, we did have the rumor that we reported from, I think it was comicbookmovie.com, that said Alan Silvestri will be the composer of choice for the Avengers, which is going to come out in May of next year. And at the time, all we knew was that it was the rumor, but we were more or less reporting on the fact that it was rumored. But now we can confirm that he is, in fact, the composer that's been chosen. So Alan Silvestri will score the Avengers for next summer. So you can look forward to what will probably be an orchestral score, but I'm guessing that he's probably going to incorporate some electronics or have something that makes it notably a little more contemporary than, say, Captain America, which was World War II era. But either way, you know, Alan Silvestri is a strong composer, so I think we have a treat in store for that. So that's pretty cool.
Yeah, I'm simply going to assume that the Alan Silvestri thing was a rumor, but that the fine people over at Marvel listened to our show, and then when we suggested that Alan Silvestri score the Avengers, they said, we need to make it happen because the Streamers and Punches guys said that we should do it. So there you go.
You know,
I should mention, we also talked about another superhero rumor a few weeks ago, which was the rumor that John Williams was going to be scoring the new Superman movie. The new Superman movie, the Man of Steel. And one of the reasons we had mentioned that as a rumor was his name showed up on the IMDb page for Man of Steel. And I noticed the other day it has now been switched. It still says John Williams, but it credits him for the original theme. So now perhaps, you know, there will be some of the John Williams theme in the film, but who knows if he'll actually be composing the score. So I don't know. We'll see.
Maybe now knowing that, maybe I feel like I should construct one of my quick 30-second excerpts that uses the Superman theme, but in the style of Hans Zimmer. Because, you know, since Dark Knight works so well, they want all their DC movies to be dark and edgy. So, yeah.
Speaking of Hans Zimmer and the Dark Knight and edgy music and all that kind of stuff, they're kind of this interesting film music experiment, if you want to call it that, that has popped up this week. If you have been following any of the Dark Knight, the Dark Knight Rises rumors and kind of footage of them shooting scenes and stuff, apparently there are scenes with like big riots and big crowds that they've been shooting on Wall Street this week. And Hans Zimmer wants to incorporate some element of that kind of thing in his score. So he wants to use samples of people like chanting and yelling and things like that. So he's actually put out an invitation for people online. You can go to this website. I'm not sure if there are various places to do it or one place. I'm looking right now at the website on ujam.com, the letter U and the word jam.com, where you can actually sit there and record whatever chant or yelling that you want to and upload it. And Hans Zimmer will possibly include that in some of the cues for The Dark Knight Rises, which is kind of neat. I mean, you know, if you're wanting to use an electronic component like that where you want to sample tons and tons and tons of people and you're famous, that's a pretty good way of going about it.
Mm-hmm. I think he stole the whole idea from Eric Whitaker personally with his little online chorus made up of singers from around the world. But that was just my gut, my first intuition, gut feeling, reaction.
Who do you think would be more offended by the accusation, Bill?
Well, I hope nobody is, but I'm not meaning to like direct slander towards anyone. But I know that they know each other.
Eric Whitaker was somehow on some level involved with Hans Zimmer's score to the latest Pirates movie. So
the Pirates,
they're good buddies. Yeah. I guess, you know.
Yeah. So he helped out Hans Zimmer because Hans Zimmer said, help Eric, I need to write choral music for the mermaid scene and I don't know how or something to that effect. And yes, our producer loves to point out that Eric Whitaker
just play all the white keys on the piano at one time in the soundtrack.
Well, actually, or you could play all the black keys at one time and still get this very similar.
Yeah.
Right. Because they're darker.
Yeah.
But anyway, so I just thought, I bet he got the idea from what Whitaker did. I mean, it worked.
Seems like it makes sense.
But I just imagine how much post time is spent amassing all of these audio files, and even if they just comb through them to select them, not that they're going to use all of them,
yeah,
but just listen to them, that's still like a god-awful amount of time. But of course, Hans Zimmer has a lot of assistants.
Why Hans Zimmer has teams of people working for him.
Yeah. Yeah, so he can like say, here, Bob, your assignment for this week is to comb over like 500 entries.
Yeah.
But anyway, so if you want to take part in that.
I thought for an idea that came to my mind was we could spend the rest of tonight's episode, Billy, just you and I recording our own chants to upload to the Hans Zimmer thing. But I think we might spare our listeners from that. Yeah,
we can just skip that, but say we did. But yeah. Anyway, for the listeners, if you guys are interested, by all means, forget our cynicism. Jump onto the UJAM website. You can get a link to it through our website of the soundnotion.tv/SAP. And check out for the link to the Dark Knight Rises. You contribute to the score for Hans Zimmer. So yeah, check that out and see if you can add something to that. That will be pretty cool to be able to say, hey, I'm on the soundtrack to the Dark Knight Rises. Not everybody can say that.
Yeah, but you won't be able to tell. So you could just tell people, and there's no way of proving that you weren't.
If they're really cool, if you send your name and your audio file, and if they're awesome.
Oh, will they tell you if they use it?
I have no idea.
Oh, okay.
But if they are cool, they'll acknowledge it in the credits, and your name would be there. Although that's too nice, so I don't know if that would happen. It makes the end credits take longer.
That's a pretty long list. Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah.
Guess is they'll probably get a few thousand submissions, so. That'd be a lot of people to think. I don't know.
I think they'll get quite a few submissions. That's for sure. Next up, we want to look at there's a radio show that's going to be narrated by Howard Shore. Kevin, you want to mention something about this?
Yeah, this was let's see, when was this radio show? This may have been. It may have passed already. This is more in line with our. Our Halloween episode that we did last week. This was a film music radio show on CBC2 that was narrated by Howard Shore. It's archived. You can go to the CBC website, and again, we'll have a link to the specific program on our website that you can find it. We spent all of our last episode talking about Halloween music, and it sounds like that this is basically what we've got with Howard Shore here is just kind of hosting this little Halloween music sort of thing. So you can check that out.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's see. We've got the Houston Symphony is going to be performing a suite or a kind of a new arrangement of the music from the Matrix movies.
I don't think it's an arrangement. I think they're playing the score along with the film.
I
thought that's what I read.
Okay, I will retract my statement. Correct.
Jeez.
They're actually going to just be recording, or rather performing live to pictures. So if you are in Houston, you can actually go catch Don Davis and watch. Let's see, is it more than just The Matrix?
I think it's just The Matrix, the first Matrix. Okay.
Yep, just the 1999 Matrix. Yep, so the only good one, as far as I'm concerned. Yeah. You're right.
Because I've seen these type of concerts before, where a score is played along with the film, or you have the majority of the score played in like a concert setting. Most of the time, when I've seen that, it tends to not work so well. Because a lot of movie scores tend to be, brass and wind heavy, that's to sit down and play all that music in one sitting, you're really asking a lot of those players. You know, I we've talked about the the Lord of the Rings symphony a couple of times, and that was certainly the case there. You know, by the time you get to the end of that 2-hour symphony, you've got the big Gondor music from the end of Return of the King that, you know, on the score for the film is probably written for, you know, a dozen French horns or something. Well, here now you've got, you know, 4 or 5 French horns with the typical symphony orchestra, and they've been playing for 2 hours. It's not gonna be the same kind of sound. And certainly the Don Davis Matrix score, really brassy, it has a lot of that John Adams kind of stuff. I wonder how well it's gonna work, because my feeling is that they're gonna have some pretty tired brass players by the time they get to the end of that.
Yeah, I'm kind of a couple minds on it. I mean, the upfront logistical, like, oh, I've been playing all night and I'm tired concerns, are those are real, and you know, you play for a couple hours and you're going to have to confront that. However, as a symphony orchestra, and any orchestra that has to play, so let's say Mahler's Third Symphony, they're looking at their, I'd say, like about an hour and a half of music, and that's feature film length right there. And they have to get assistant brass principal players, like an assistant horn principal or an assistant trumpet principal, or things like that. They're used to doing that. And same with operas, because operas tend to be very long, although not as difficult.
But do you still think you see that Mahler, of course, uses a lot of brass and a lot of woodwinds, but do you think that, you know, especially with a score like the Matrix, it's a lot of brass, it's really dense and high and loud and all of those tiring things, you know, Mahler still knows that he has to allow for breaks and things like that, and it's not just constant playing. But when Don Davis is writing the score for the Matrix and they're going to spend 2 weeks recording it, he doesn't have to worry about that. So it's true. There's a lot of brass in Mahler and in opera, and especially in Wagner, but I would still on average think that there's still more heavy brass playing in a lot of these big film scores. I don't know. It'll be interesting.
In some. I would much rather, if I was a brass player, I'd much rather be playing the Matrix probably than any of the Star Wars movies, just because one is constant, and the other, I mean, the Matrix has lots of breaks, because if you recall, there's a lot of like heavy metal used throughout, and although the movie itself is not, it's not like high adrenaline the whole time, it has a big opening, it has a couple moments in the middle, and then it has a huge ending. I think the music and the sort of the breadth of the score mirror that. So as far as involvement of the instruments. However, on the bigger picture, I think this is actually good, because orchestras need to find ways to kind of adapt in the modern world, because what they're doing is something that's hundreds of years old, and it's just proving to always have thinner and thinner audiences. So I'm not saying this is the only way orchestras should appear in public at all, far from it, but they are still used on film scores, and in the case of the Matrix, it's a great example, and it's not 30 years old. It's only about 10 or, well, I guess
10 or 12 at this point. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. And it's at least using a little more modern compositional techniques, but it's still a full orchestra. And I think it's great that they're at least them being able to play it live says, hey, we're an orchestra and we're actually live. And so it is bringing attention to the art of the ensemble and what they can do, although it's certainly not showing all of what they're capable of doing. Mm-hmm. But I think it's cool, and I think they should keep doing it in a realistic way, not maybe playing, you know, a 2-hour movie is enough, because it's a movie. It's you're being entertained, and the orchestra is getting, you know, exhausted near the end. But, you know, something like the Lord of the Rings, you know, it's like, okay, fine, go for it, but you're going to have much more logistical issues with that, but overall I think it's a very positive thing, so I think it's cool.
Yeah, it should be neat. I know I think part of this association, at least I'm kind of guessing here, I think within the last year or two Don Davis had an opera come out, and I think the Houston opera was maybe part of that commissioning process and things like that. So I wonder if this project has come about as an association from that. It's certainly, it's not like the Howard Shore Lord of the Rings thing where it's going to be going on tour. This seems like it's just something with the Houston Symphony. But yeah, I mean, It would be it'll be interesting. Yeah, it'll be interesting to see how it does and if it ends up with some other major orchestras. Like you said, Bill, you know, orchestras are having a difficult go at things, and they're having to do more and more of this kind of stuff. Just try and sell some extra tickets.
Well, they're gonna orchestras are gonna need to evolve. So
yeah, I mean the players may not be crazy about playing this kind of thing, but you know, the orchestras have to do.
I mean, for orchestras, it's identical to an opera. Really, you're just accompanying what right. the actual main feature is for the evening. So anyway, well, yeah, okay. I mean, we've got we've gotten the Howard Shore stuff out of the way. Alan Silvestri.
Yep.
You can go to Film Tracks if you're curious about, you know, there's a couple of John Williams scores that are on the horizon. And as we were even mentioning before the show, you know, we certainly are no strangers to John Williams' music and have talked about him a number of times on the show. But it's important to note that, you know, this composer is sort of he's just sort of the king in a lot of ways of American cinematic writing for film, and he has demonstrated that a number of times, and just, you know, the box office for films that he has scored is enough to prove it. But then he's done television and he's done other venues as well, and he has been out of the scene for quite a while, especially if you kind of ignore the last Indiana Jones movie, which I know a lot of people do, unfortunately. Maybe
choose to ignore that it exists.
That was 2008. Is that right, Kevin?
I think so. Yeah, that sounds right.
Okay, and then before that, there was, I think you have to go back to 2006 before you get the last couple films that John Williams scored. So it is kind of exciting, and we do want to stress that, because he's not getting any younger, and yet from the sound of some of the demos, or rather some of the preview tracks that we've heard, it's fine that he's not getting any younger, because the music is full of character and colorful and seems very cinematic and very appropriate. Mm-hmm. And it's just nice to have a holiday season approaching with not just one new score, but two new scores coming out, and both totally different yet both being connected to Spielberg, which is right. not a bad thing at all. So we definitely want to point out that's why, maybe if we're gushing about it, that's why we find it significant. Just like if Jerry Goldsmith were still alive, I would be talking about something new that significant that he would be coming out with if he were still writing.
And if he were dead and came out with some new music, then we would really be talking about it.
That would be a very significant addition. Yes, definitely.
Jerry Goldsmith teams up with Tupac for a new score. Yeah.
Oh. I'd be fine taking dead Jerry Goldsmith just to write it. Or, you know, we can leave Tupac out of it, but. But Film Tracks has a review of the 1010 score, and so you can definitely get the link to that on our website, yep. which again is the soundnotion.tv/sap.
Yep.
If
you've never checked out any of the reviews at Film Tracks, just filmtracks.com, it's pretty cool. They go, the reviews are pretty in depth, and most of them tend to go into, somewhat of an analytical type of thing, where they'll go through a score kind of theme by theme, and it really kind of digs into it. It's not just, oh, this is the score for the latest movie and it sounds adventurous. And I mean, it really kind of digs into it. So yeah, you can go there and check out this Tintin review, but you know, you can find reviews for lots of other scores as well. And some of the reviews can be pretty informative. Yeah.
Are those are not the ones by Daniel Schweiger, are they?
Off the top of my head, I can't remember.
Because I think Daniel Schweiger does the ones for Film Music Magazine, the one where Mark Northam is editor.
Friend of the show, Mark Northam.
Yeah. Friend of the show. That's right.
Mark Northam.
Filmmusicmagazine.com. Visit.
Yeah, I'm looking at the I'm looking at the Tintin review now, and I don't see a name on it, so I'm not entirely sure.
Who
wrote this review?
All right. Well, definitely check that out. And then, kind of on the coattails of that, there is a radio show. This is this Austin W or K KMFA? Is that Austin, Texas, where that's happening, Kevin?
I have no idea.
Okay, we can
check
that real quick.
It's somewhere west of the Mississippi, I'll tell you that. Because it starts with a K and not a W.
Narrowed it down.
Yes, Austin, Texas. You're right.
Okay. Okay, so this is... This is being done by actually another composer named Brian Satterwhite. He's hosting a show, and he just simply calls it The Return of John Williams. And he's going to be showcasing some of the music from both of the scores coming out this holiday season. And it's an easy date to remember. It's November 11th of this year, otherwise known as 11-11-11. Mm-hmm. So if you want to hear some of the previews of both of those scores on basically an internet radio station, check that out. Again, we'll have the link on our website.
Yeah, a couple of weeks ago, we got a few samples of these two scores on, I think it was WQXR out of New York. But it looks like we're going to get quite a bit more of it on this particular radio show. There's a playlist here, and it looks like we've got about 6 tracks from Tintin and 5 tracks from Warhorse. So it should be quite a bit of music from these two new CDs, which should be coming out within, I mean, Tintin should be coming out within the next couple of weeks or something, and then Warhorse, that CD is maybe closer to Christmas. One of them is coming out in November, though, aren't they, Bill? I don't remember.
Actually, yeah, I've got a little bit in just a moment. I got a little bit I wanted to add to that about when they're coming out.
Okay.
Kevin? Do you want to talk a little bit about the Karen Hahn?
Yeah, there was a really kind of an interesting interview with a musician named Karen Hahn. This is from a European website. It's runmovies.eu. And it's an interview with Karen Hahn. Now, Karen Hahn plays an instrument called an erhu. I don't want to say it's a violin. It is a bowed string instrument. It's a two-string Chinese violin, basically. But it's an instrument that, for its individual and unique color, has been used quite a bit lately in a lot of recent scores. In this interview, it talks about she recorded this instrument several years ago on Rachel Portman's score to the Joy Luck Club. She worked with John Debney on Passion of the Christ, John Williams on Memoirs of a Geisha, and I think most recently recorded some music for Hans Zimmer for the new Pirates of the Caribbean, or no, I'm sorry, for Pirates of the Caribbean at World's End, which was 2 movies ago. So it's an interesting interview that she talks about, you know, the differences between playing kind of the original authentic music written for this instrument, and how she'd had to change her playing technique to play film scores, because written in a Western, usually tonal language, it's a different vocabulary. Bill, was this also the instrument that was used? I think maybe it was the instrument that was used in Michael Giacchino's Star Trek score for Spock's theme.
For Spock, I think so. Yes.
It doesn't look like it's Karen that played that, but I think that was the same instrument. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's a pretty interesting interview. You can check it. I think that we've got it on. We'll have the link for you up on our website. I don't know. I think the interview may be actually a few years old, and it just reposted. So, you know, considering how that this is, I think, a 4-year-old interview that we're just now stumbling upon, it's entirely possible that that she recorded for the Star Trek film.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Okay. All right.
I just looked it up on IMDb, and sure enough, she did. That was her playing on Star Trek. She also played on, let's see, Kung Fu Panda 2, and
naturally,
2012, the Roland Emmerich movie, and Up in the Air, and yeah, so all sorts of stuff.
Okay.
So, you know, you look at, you find some of these unique instruments, and that show up in scores, and it seems like there's always that one person that does all of the work. You know, back in the 70s and 80s, you had Toots Thielman, who was like this virtuoso harmonica player, and basically anytime you heard harmonica in a film score, it was this one guy that was playing it, because he was the guy to go to, you know.
Every time, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, okay. Well, that sort of wraps up the proper section of the headlines. I did want to have like a follow-up to that, but only talking about one single thing, and that is CD soundtracks or rather reissues or expanded releases or things like that. For some of our listeners, you may be interested in this. You may be collectors yourself. I kind of am a collector a little bit. I mostly just purchase them because I enjoy the music and because I don't like to only own MP3s of something. So I still actually will invest in the CDs. There are a number of companies out there that we've mentioned before, like FilmScore Monthly, who still sort of reissues things and finds the old tape tracks and are able to sort of remaster them and create new versions with expanded releases. There are a number of labels out there now that are really helpful to the collectors as well. So I wanted to mention a couple because at least one of them is already sold out, and that is a few weeks ago, 1941, which is a movie not made in 1941, but rather I think in 81 or 1980. It was directed by... Yeah, it was directed by Spielberg, and it was right when he was, I want to say he was
right off of Jaws and Close Encounters.
Pretty successful as a director, and right. I almost think he probably had the whole kind of like Midas touch and maybe some ego going on, and then famously made this comedy with a huge amount of stars and a big budget, and it totally tanked. And,
I think it's really funny, but it was.
Well, I think in recent and in later years, people have gone back to it. But it has a huge John Williams score, full orchestra, and he's right in the middle of that whole time period where he's very prolific, and there's a lot of George Lucas and Spielberg movies he's involved in, and this is just another one of them. And he's got a lot of themes. He actually works in some swing music in the score, along with I think the Rakes of Mallow, which is sort of a traditional Irish tune. I actually have like the older soundtrack release, and I kind of feel like that's all right. But I'm screwed because this new version, which is two CDs, and I think was selling for somewhere around $25 to $29, it's already sold out. So it's completely completely gone.
This business model of releasing these small batches of re-releases is kind of interesting because.
Well, they're almost certain to get them all sold out.
Right. But it makes you wonder, what is it that people are really buying these things for? Because let's buy this so that we can have the music, but these aren't things that show up on Amazon or iTunes or something where you can download them in MP3 format. It's people. I get the sense that, especially when you see how fast that they sell out, and the outrageous prices that people tend to be reselling them for once they are sold out.
Right.
It's maybe not quite so much about the music, but it's more about having the thing.
Yeah. There's an absurdity to it, and it's kind of stupid. But
yeah.
But people value it for the wrong reasons. But anyway, what I wanted to say though is that 1941 came out a few weeks ago. It was a two CD version. It's already gone. And it was sold through ScreenArchives.com is a fantastic website, and they operate out of Virginia, and they're really good on their selection, and I've ordered from them a number of times. So I don't mean this to be an advertisement for them, but they're a pretty good place to go in general. If you can't get the 1941, Midway, which is a late 70s movie, also from a kind of a World War II era, but I believe a little more serious, and I had Charlton Heston in the film, along with, I think, Henry Fonda and a couple other actors, also with a John Williams score. And if you know any of his marches that he tends to do in concerts for encores, the Midway March is in there about almost as much as the march from 1941. So if you can't get 1941, you can still get Midway. It's a single CD release. It's still available. Now, for a lot of collectors, the Gremlins score by Goldsmith came out just last week. It's two CDs, and it looks like it's still available. And this is something that for decades, since 1984, has been a huge collector's issue in bootleg and everything else. And at least the bootlegs show me that people are interested in the music, if not maybe the collectible part of it, but they want so much to be able to get these scores that they go for the bootlegs on eBay and whatnot. But now you don't have to go to Screen Archives or go to buysoundtracks.com or any of these websites, and they should still have the Gremlins 2 CD set available. For any fans of Christopher Young, who's a prolific composer, although not as famous or household name as Hans Zimmer or James Horner.
Seems to be busier these days, though.
Yeah, I mean, he fell in with Sam Raimi on a couple projects, and that ended up.
Wasn't he? I don't know if this is still the case. In fact, I don't think it is, because I think the position is open. But wasn't he the head of the film scoring department at USC? And I think maybe now he's not doing that and spending more time doing films. I don't know.
I don't know what his job situation is at the moment, but he definitely was heading up the program. So a very cool guy and always supportive of working with young composers. So he was pretty cool, but I mean, very capable, different styles. And often he would do films that sometimes, like Jerry Goldsmith, the film really wasn't that great, but you'd hear something in the music that was like, no, that's kind of cool. Or what's he taking that idea and doing with that? And he would sometimes turn in a pretty decent score or an above average score for a below average movie. And so sometimes Christopher Young has done that. But the core, which depending on your opinion may or not fit in.
I was just going to say, are you insinuating that the core is a below average movie?
Art as well as beauty is left in the eye of the beholder.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
So you can judge that for yourself. But the core is a 2 CD release that's now available. And that's, and Christopher Young's scores have not been huge. Like, they're not, like, you don't find them in Walmart like you would the latest Star Wars score or something. And the final thing I want to add about the soundtrack CD news is that the two John Williams ones we mentioned earlier are both available for pre-order. The Adventures of Tintin is set to be released on the 13th of December. But sooner, Warhorse is set to be released on the 21st of November. So you can actually order both of those through screenarchives.com, probably buy soundtracks. And actually, since those will probably get general release, then Amazon.
Yeah, I think there are pre-orders up on Amazon and all that kind of stuff as well.
Yeah, okay. Cool. So that's going to kind of conclude the soundtrack news. So like we mentioned, we got a little bit of a smaller show today, but that means that it's no less interesting or exciting. We wanted to save some special music for the end. Basically, if you like this segment, we wanted to devote to an exclusive preview, I suppose, the first...
Semi-exclusive.
Right?
We've taken it from someone else's exclusive preview.
That's right. So it's like secondhand exclusive. And if you heard it here before the other place, then you truly heard it here first. So we wanted to play some excerpts from The Adventures of Tintin for our If You Like This segment. And is there a cue title for this one, Kevin?
There is, but I certainly don't remember what it was.
Okay. So that's part of the mystery, folks. So there you go. Yeah. You don't know where this is from, but you know it's from The Adventures of Tintin. So
it's kind of cool. It has some of William's jazzier elements. It sounds a little bit like, you know, some of his Harry Potter stuff, and a little bit like Catch Me If You Can or something along those lines. So
it does bear the sort of fingerprint of John Williams, but I do feel like it has a nice kind of character identity all its own. But well, anyway, so we're going to play a little bit of that in just a second. So that'll do it for this episode of Streamers and Punches. As always, you can listen to us on soundnotion.tv/SAP, and where you can subscribe to our show, leave comments, and find links to the music that we spoke about, as well as the links. I already said that. It's redundant day.
Eh.
You can also subscribe to the show through the iTunes store. As always, my name is Bill Witham.
And I'm Kevin Wilt.
And here's a little bit from The Adventures of Tintin by John Williams. Thank you for listening.